we're going to talk about healthcare. Okay? Obviously, they passed the Affordable Care Act. Has anybody read that? Or are you in the same boat as Nancy Pelosi that said this is great, as she stands next to the stack of paper about 4.5 feet tall, says this is the greatest legislation we've ever seen. We just need to pass it, and then we can find out what it does. Okay? Obviously, after it was passed, there was a lot of people, the first year they did their tax returns, that were totally shocked as to how the procedure worked. Okay? Basically, what the law did, it says that everybody has to have health insurance of one form or another. Okay? And it's a mandate. And then our Supreme Court said that, yes, it is a tax. Okay? So everything lined up for them, and they set up the exchanges. Those are the marketplace. Some states like New York have their own exchange. Some are run by the federal government. Okay? States that, like Florida, that don't file and really have a lot to do with state income tax, didn't really find the need to really do anything. It's not anything that's on your state tax return, but they just felt like they wanted to be under the federal law. Okay? All right. So, as it says here, we're going to talk about how exemptions work. The big thing that the penalty is called the shared responsibility. Doesn't that sound nice and soft and politically correct? The shared responsibility. Okay. We're going to talk about the PTC or the APTC, which is the premium tax credit. That is based on your household's income, and you got insurance through the marketplace. We're going to talk about the tax credit and how that's handled on the tax return. Okay? All right. 15-4. Okay? Health coverage is based on the tax family. When I do an application within the marketplace, I do it based on their tax household. Okay, so that is anybody that shows up on the tax return. It's not who lives under my roof. It is based on my tax household because that's the way all the computations are done. So if I have a 27-year-old son that lives with me, but he is not on my tax return, it is not my responsibility to show him on my tax return whether he has insurance or not. He or she is on their own, okay? So that's where it is considered the tax family. In order to not pay the penalty, everybody has to have minimum essential coverage. Basically what that is hospitalization. All right. One example of something that meets minimum essential coverage is Medicare Part A. That's your hospitalization. You don't have to have B. You just have to have A. Okay. Now, there's a bunch of different things that can meet the coverage, whether they be through your employer, or whether they be through your military with TRICARE, or if it's the case that you're a Canadian national living here in the United States and you have health insurance that you're covered through like Canada does with their universal plan, you just have to have minimum coverage, which means basically hospitalization. They wanted to prevent those cases where somebody walks into the hospital, does not have insurance, and somebody's going to have to foot the bill. Okay? All right. And basically what they're trying to get away from is letting everybody use the emergency room as their primary care, whether it be for simple things or whatever it may be. I did witness a situation. I was when I started out, I was working a lot with the Niagara Falls. And there was a lady that was in the emergency room when I met the individual I was meeting with there. And she's writhing in pain, causing quite a scene. Had no health insurance. Couldn't afford, she said, to get her meds. And just creating quite a scene. The oddest thing was, 45 minutes later when I walked out after my meeting, she's standing on the street corner on her phone, says, I'm all set. Must be the greatest hospital in the world. Because, boy, they cured whatever was wrong with her because I thought she was dying. because she was on a gurney just writhing in pain. Okay, so that's an example where somebody was using the emergency room to fill their prescriptions, whether they were legitimate or not. Which, again, not everybody's that way, but you do see instances, and that's where they're trying to find a way to keep the system down. Because for any of you that have been hospitalized, the last thing you want to do is a $800 aspirin. And, you know, if you walk down to Walgreens, you can get a box of gauze Band-Aids for about $3. And I forget the term that they call them, but they're like, there's some fancy term for what they use for a Band-Aid in the hospital. And you're paying about $5 for them per Band-Aid. So, you know, they have to cover the cost because everybody's in there. Okay. Now, you can opt out. As it says here, health covered exemptions. You can find a way to not have to pay the mandate. Okay. You can get it granted by a marketplace. Okay. You can do it on the tax return. Or it may just simply be because of your income, your filing threshold. Okay, you'll see on the form how that works. The ones that are granted by the marketplace, you have to complete a form. Now there's two forms. First one is a hardship form that you kind of do after the fact. Okay, all right, so a hardship form you do after the fact. All right, what I mean by that, any type of hardship. There's 14 of them on there, and let me see if I can find them here. Okay. I think I tried to do this once before for you. We'll see if it works this time. Oh, I might have it. This would be wonderful. Still doing that, isn't it? I did try to open it. Shoot. Nope, that's not going to be on there, is it? Nope. Okay, we don't have Adobe Reader. All right. So, the hardship form has 14 categories. 1 through 13 is typical hardships. Okay? You lost your job. You had to stop working to take care of a family member. Okay? You have a shutoff notice. Your house is in foreclosure. You're filing bankruptcy. It can be just about anything. Then number 14 is any other hardship that you experienced, please provide support so you can make up your own. Okay? So you can file that form. The other form is for a hardship is based on something you know is going to be the case for the upcoming year. Okay? What I mean by that is basically I have to, if it's a case that I'm not going to purchase insurance and I know I'm not going to get insurance for 2017, I have to put the form in ahead of the time. Because I'm going to say, based on my income, I can't afford to buy insurance for the upcoming year. So one exemption is kind of after the fact. The other exemption is ahead of the fact. Okay? And we'll see how those work in the form. All right? The little table on 15.6 is great because it talks about all of the different columns and what you have to do, okay? And it gives the codes. All right. There is a one that we see quite often is a short-term gap. Okay. 3 months or less. Basically, you think about it, you change jobs, your new employer, sometimes what is there? Might be a 60 or 90 day waiting period before you get benefits. So basically that's what that covers. All right. Unaffordable. If my employer provides me insurance and it's greater than 9.56% of my gross income, then I can put in for unaffordable and try to go into the marketplace. Now, trust me, now that the mandate has kicked in for employers for having to provide insurance for their 25 or more full-time employees, they know what 9.56% is, and they're right up to it, okay? And the other thing is, to keep that number in place, they've gone to high deductible plans where they allow people to do health savings accounts, okay? We talked a little bit about health savings, but that 9.56%, every employer that has, because if they don't provide you insurance with 25 or more full-time employees and you opt out, they pay a penalty. So employers are on the hook too for a penalty, okay? Shared responsibility payment. Basically, what that is for everyone in your house that does not have insurance, you pay a penalty for each month. All right. This year, it's $695 a person, or 2.5% of your adjusted gross income, whichever is greater. Kids are half of that $695, okay? So for each month, basically what's happened with that 2.5%, the least expensive plan in the marketplace is basically going to be equivalent to the penalty of not having insurance. So you have a choice. Lose part of your tax refund or pay for health insurance. That's what it boils down to, okay? So those are your two choices, all right? Okay. If you remember on, let's see, on page 15-8, it has our 2015 numbers. The top was 2% and 325 per an adult with a maximum of $975 per tax return. This year that max is about $2,085. Okay? So that's climb quite a bit. The other thing is, you do not have to pay the penalty if you're below the filing threshold. So we remember back from our early chapters when we determined if somebody was eligible or had to file a tax return, so they might still file a tax return even though their income is below the filing threshold. But if their income is below that, then they do not have to pay the penalty. Okay? All right. 15-9 shows how we get proof of health coverage. If somebody's in the marketplace, they'll get a 1095A. That's something that we use on the tax return. We cannot complete their tax return without the 1095A. Okay? 1095B, you will get from the marketplace or your employer or Medicare or Medicaid, and it's just proof to show which months you had coverage so that we can validate that. Remember our ACA worksheet that we're going to talk and go a little more in depth to. 1095C is something that you'd use. And again, it shows what months somebody that was employed and their employer provided the insurance. It shows those months, but it also shows what they were offering and how much it cost. So again, that's where that 9.56%. So if you have somebody that's trying to opt out, they're going to have to prove to you with a 1095C to show what their price would have been. And the fact of unaffordable, it's only for the employee on the return. If I'm married, filing joint with two kids, and I get insurance from my employer, I'm the only one that does the calculation for 9.56%. I can't use the family plan and show that it's expensive. I can only do it for myself, the employee. Okay, so that's that little stipulation that's on there. All right. There's a form, the 8965. We're going to talk about how to fill those out. All right, we'll talk about the shared responsibility. All right, 1515, the premium tax credit. What that is if you go through the marketplace and only through the marketplace, you can get a credit to help you pay your monthly premiums. You do not get this credit if you go directly to an insurance company or you have an employer-based plan. You only get this credit through the marketplace, through the government. Okay? Every time, everybody thought at first that this was for everybody. And the quote, our great leader, Nancy Pelosi, it was in there. We'll read about it after we pass it. Everybody had this misconception that they were going to get a tax credit on their employer plan. Okay? You can get it two ways, this premium tax credit. You can take it in your monthly premium. So if I have independent health and it costs me $500 and I get a $200 credit from the marketplace, I'm sending checks to independent health for $300. Okay? Or I cannot take it each month and it'll just show up as a big credit on my tax return. You have your choice. Okay? I have people do it both ways. All right. The credit is based on projected income. So right now I'm working on several people and I'm setting up their health care because we're in the open enrollment period. I have to project their 2017 income. It's not based on anything historical. It's all based on projections in the future. Okay. Not that I believe in them, but I keep asking Esther for a crystal ball. So I can tell these people, here's exactly what's going to happen to them in 2017, so we're as accurate as possible. My purchase order has been denied, okay? What happens is when you do this and something changes, if you got too much or too little of a premium tax credit on a monthly basis, you're either going to get more refund or pay it back on your tax return. Best example is I sit and I do somebody right now and they don't let me know that anything changed throughout the year and they end up taking $10,000 out of a retirement account. Well, we know from doing taxes, what's that cost? Taxable income, our income goes up. Okay, so when I go to look at their tax return at the end of the year, I said, you didn't tell me. So now you have to pay back all the extra money you got to help pay for your health insurance and your refund's gone. Plus, you have taxable income, plus you have a penalty because you're under 59 and a half, you owe the federal government $2,500. And the look on their face, I hate this insurance. You know, they thought it was a great deal, they had an opportunity to get insurance. But if we don't keep track of their income, we have problems. Same thing happens with self-employment, because what is it? That's a guessing game. We're running our own business, we're not sure. It's not like we have a paycheck that we know we're making $1,000 a week. Self-employment, well, my sales were up, my expenses were down, I got more, we calculated wrong. So we have to always keep track of that, okay? All right. So that's the premium tax credit. If you look on 1517, okay, everything for the healthcare law is based on the poverty level, okay? So if you look at here for the premium tax credit, anybody below, well, in New York, it's 138%, but in the nation, most states, it's 100% of the federal poverty level, which is $11,670. Below that, you're on Medicaid. So anywhere between 100% and 400% of the federal poverty level, you get help paying for your health insurance. So if you're a household of four, mom, dad, two kids, and you make less than $95,000 and you have to get insurance through the marketplace, you're going to get help paying for your health insurance.
Okay. Now, chances are somebody has a job that they're making $95,000. I bet they have benefits. Okay. So I bet they have benefits. So, you know, you don't see a lot of those, but you do see a few.
Okay. Page 1518, you see the 1095A, which now, if somebody has a marketplace application or does their insurance through the marketplace, you will be required to see that prior to doing the return. Okay? Or a 1095B that shows the months that they have. Okay? All right. And that is healthcare. Ta-da. Okay. All right. So we're going to kind of show you what goes on here. All right. So this is kind of the software version. So I'm going to get my friend Harry Healthcare. All right. Now, once we've done the return, we know that we have to go to our ACA worksheet and we have to find out, going through all the questions. This is on the federal return only. There's none of this on the state. We got to find out, where did your insurance come from? Now, the first question is tricky because if you get Medicaid or the essential plan through the marketplace, you're going to say, no, I didn't get insurance from the market. Okay? So if they have Medicaid or the essential plan, which you'll see on a 1095B, you say no, even though they purchased it through the marketplace. Okay? The reason being is this little form, 8962. That 8962 is generated only when they get an advanced premium tax credit, the premium tax credit. Okay? Second one, if we have somebody on the insurance that has a gap, we're going to put in for an exemption. That's where you see the other form, the 8965. Okay? All right. So, the rest of the questions here are about the most confusing. You should have seen the one for 14. It was even more fun. Okay? I haven't seen the one for 16 yet, so I don't know. But on this one, you have to decide, did they have insurance all 12 months? Okay? And again, 1095As and 1095Bs. Okay? Did they have coverage part of the year? Or did they have no insurance? Okay? If I check B, okay, then I have to put down here the months that they did not have insurance and do not have an exemption. So say for Harry here, January, February, and March, he did not have insurance, okay? But I'm gonna put in for as an exemption for 3 months, I don't check those boxes, okay? Because if I check those boxes, so I'm gonna say he had it, and I'm gonna put January, February, and March, okay? Once I do that, when I go to my second page, it's going to calculate $325 a month. So when you check those months, you're making them pay the penalty. Okay? All right. Okay. And then as you can see, what happens is there's a little calculation that based on their household's income, they do some percentage things. This penalty is only going to be $81 for those months. Okay? So it's not like he pays $325. There is a graduated scale based on their income. And it does all the calculation. I'm not going to ask you to learn how to do the calculation. Okay? Because not even the IRS knows how to do it. Trust me, I know. All right. So I have that case where they had those. But if I'm going to do an exemption, okay, I don't check any of those. All right. I'm going to check the first box, all 12 months. Okay. All right. Reason being is, as it says, had minimum essential coverage and or is applying for or was granted an exemption for all 12 months. So basically what I'm saying is I have covered all 12 months. He had insurance for 9 months and I'm giving him the exemption for 3 months. Okay. Once I know that that's the case, I'm going to check yes. And on my tree, I'm going to generate an 8965, okay, which is my exemption form. All right. So since we know he's going to have an exemption, we're going to go take a look at our 8965. Okay. So, part one of this form is where we talk about marketplace. We know for him that he's going to have that exemption because it's a short-term gap. Let's say he didn't have insurance for the whole year because his wife was ill, could not work, he had to stay home, take care of the kids. So, we're going to put him in for a hardship. We'll put his name, we'll put a social security number. That form I was talking about, the hardship form, all right? Once you issue that, they'll give you a certificate number. Well, that certificate number can take several months. Obviously, we do not want to delay their refund. So, we can say that they're going to have that So we're going to put in Harry Healthcare. Don't worry about a social security number. And over here, oddly enough,
the word pending fits right in there. You think they planned it?
So I can put pending in there. This will be e-filed. They will issue the refund as if the return was done completely. Obviously, we know that later on, we're going to have these catch up to each other. Now, they don't turn in that form. We kind of put it on them. They're going to get a love letter in about 6 months after they receive their refund from the IRS saying, hey, you don't get the exemption. You got to pay the penalty for not having insurance, and here's penalties and interest. You owe us your refund back plus this. The people just love to get that letter. Okay. Part two, you can see it does our filing threshold for us. This family's filing threshold is $20,600, but according to our ACA worksheet that we did when we filled out all their information, we know their income, so they are not going to be able to get off for not having enough money or being below the filing threshold. Okay. All right. Part three. Don't worry, there's only 12 parts. Just kidding. Part three is the last of our exemption options. Part A, we have to do the form because we have to mail that form in, either whether it's prior to the year because they don't want to get insurance and they know they can't afford it the upcoming year, or at the end of the year they determine they had a hardship. Exempt. Part two, their income's below the filing threshold. Part three, they have an exemption that we can put on the tax return. And this is where we most commonly see the short-term gap. Okay? Either they lost their job and it went into the marketplace, but they had a couple months in there, or they got a new job and they have 2 or 3 months, or all the other ones that you saw on that other page, if they can convince you that they are the member of a certain Indian tribe, or they have joined some religious sect that allows them that they, because of their religious beliefs, they don't have to have health insurance. Okay? Anybody in here that part of that? Anybody's in a cult or something like that? Okay. I guess I should ask that at the beginning of the class in case, first day of class, asking if anybody's in a cult. Okay. So name, social security number, exemption type. Like I said, we have those letters, A, B, C, D, that you see on the one form. You can always hit F1, okay? This is where, in this case, for Harry, we're going to put Harry in there. And he has a, whoops, did I miss something? Oh, one more number. Okay, and we're going to put him in there as a B, short-term gap. And we're going to say that he is exempt for those 3 months. So remember how I said on that one, I checked that he had it all year long. So now I've accounted for the 3 months for his exemption. And the other 9 months he had through his new employer. So I've covered all 12 months for him. Okay? As I said, you can go in here for the exemptions, and if you hit F1, and, oops, under the part 3, there is, click here for exemption codes. Okay, and it's the exact same little chart that you see in your textbook. So again, coverage is considered unaffordable. Well, even if you went to the marketplace, it was going to be greater than 8.05%. This is not the employer percentage. This is marketplace or buyage somewhere. It was going to be greater than 8.05% of your income. Again, the individual that does not have insurance. All right? Okay? Because if the individual that does not have insurance is unemployed, what would they be eligible for? Medicaid. What's the premium for Medicaid? Sounds pretty affordable to me, okay? All right, understand where the calculation comes in, okay? Here's that one I use, the B, short-term coverage gap, 3 months, okay? You can see as we go down the chart there, we have one for citizens living abroad. We have one that you are in a healthcare sharing ministry. Everybody know what those are? You hear them advertised quite a bit. It's a good old-fashioned what the unions used to do. It's a co-op. All right? You're in a ministry, and they have a group, and everybody comes together, pools their money by paying in a premium, and then when they have a claim, they pay the bill, submit it, and are reimbursed, just like a co-op. Okay? However, those co-ops, they end up having a lot of pre-existing stipulations because they're excluded from the law. Okay? Like I said, member of a tribe. If you're incarcerated, trust me, I know how to enroll you. So if you do become incarcerated, call me. I'll get you the best health insurance you've ever had. Okay? All right? And then we said, you know, the members of the household, born, adopted, died, things like that. So there's different determinations here. All right? Okay? The one for the members of certain religious sects, we have to do that one. You have to do it ahead of time. You can't at the end of the year say, oh, yeah, by the way, I was a Christian Science and I don't believe that we have to have health insurance or health care. I don't believe in doctors. Or at the end of the year, you said, yeah, I took a vow of poverty and I became a monk, so I don't have to pay the penalty. You have to do that ahead of time. You have to say you're going to be a monk for the upcoming year. Fred's contemplating his next career choice. He's back there going, what's that? Yeah, for 17, you have to, yeah. So, yep. So after Christmas, tell the family, hey, I'm going to be on sabbatical for a year. I become a monk, so I don't have to pay for our health insurance. So, all right. So you can see, you know, and again, some of these sound very odd, but, you know, that is the case where those exemptions come into play, okay? Now, last thing is on our ACA worksheet, if we say yes, that they did get health insurance from the marketplace, we're going to see a little form called an 8962 pop up on our tree. Okay? 8962 is the one that will reconcile their premium tax credit, what they got to help pay for their insurance. All right? It knows the family size, their income, and even though I may have a son that's working at Tim Hortons making $5,000, his $5,000, is that on my tax return? No, it's not. He's filed his own, right? But in the case of health insurance, because he's part of my tax household, I have to count his income. So this is where a lot of people got caught off guard first year. Because when you do the application, you have to put your dependent's income in the application, even though it's not on your tax return. What that means is we're not using the adjusted gross income that we see at the bottom of page one of our 1040. We're using what's called MAGI. In the spirit of Christmas, okay? Like that one, Michelle? Okay, they come bearing gifts. All right? And sometimes it's not a very good gift, is it? You have to put on there, modified adjusted gross income. I have to add the kid's income. So my kid's income actually shows up on my tax return. All right, so if they made $5,000, I have to put it on there. The other thing, modified adjusted gross income for Social Security, you count the gross. You do not count the net. So if I have $20,000 worth of Social Security and I'm 62 years old, it might not be taxable. But for healthcare, I have to count the whole $20,000, not just the taxable portion. So again, a lot of people got caught off guard because what's everybody have a mindset with Social Security? Tax-free, I don't put on my tax return. Or your health insurance, okay? So as we go down, we're gonna check that we're part, obviously the poverty level in Alaska and Hawaii must be different because they get their own little box. But we're gonna say that we're in the 48 states, okay? So once that's done, it takes a look and it says, well, my household is at 129% of the poverty level. So it's telling me what percentage of the poverty level my house is. Okay? That's going to determine how much I should be eligible for. All right? That I should be eligible for. Okay? As I go down a little farther, we can see here that they're saying that I should be able to contribute $43 a month for my family's house health insurance. Okay? Now, part two, this is where we reconcile. What did they get, and was it enough, or was it too much? Okay? shared policy allocation, an alternative calculation for year of marriage. I'm not even going to teach you how to do it because I'm still in the process of teaching the IRS how to do it, okay? And you think I'm being facetious? Is that the word? We have a client right now that got married, was in the marketplace, and after he got married, he went on his wife's health insurance, okay? So for the months that he was unmarried, on the tax return, we have to calculate an alternative premium tax credit. We did that, sent in the return, he gets a letter. You owe us X number of dollars. No, you don't. We sent back to the IRS, he did a alternative calculation for the year of marriage. IRS sends a letter back. He owes us. So we get on the phone. After being transferred four times, I end up with an ACA
IRS specialist level two. Okay, they bypassed level one because apparently level two, I went right to the chief. And after 30 minutes of explaining our case on the phone, after being on hold for 45, she goes, to be honest with you, none of us know how to do the calculation here. So here's a government agent, ACA level two specialist for the government's healthcare law. They don't know how it is. So boy, did I have fun. I said, well, let me tell you how it works. If you go to this publication and then you go to the form instructions, you put these together, you do, and she goes, oh, can you send that to me? Sure. So certified mail, I got my little green postcard back, so she got it. So hopefully she's teaching the rest of the IRS how their forms work. All right? CPAs hate this. I don't know how many CPAs have sent people with these problems to us to do this, just because the word's out that we are capable of doing it, both enrolling them and doing it. CPAs wanted nothing to do with this part of the healthcare law, the tax return, okay? So, as it says there, all the word that you have to know about that box one where it says yes, is just say skip, okay? So we're gonna do box two, where we get to go to line 10. Now line 10, what happens here is we have to decide, did they get on their 1095A marketplace all year or a part year, okay? All right, and we're just gonna do in here that they have a, you know, whatever it will do, and we'll just see it in the problems, whether they had a part year or whatever it may be. Then what happens is based on the numbers on our 1095A, it'll say you get more credit or you had excess and you owe it back. Now, the fun part about this, remember that percentage of the poverty level? Prior to us checking the box, what was the number that was there? Anybody remember? 401%? Because 400% is where the credit stops, okay? So if I have a family of four that's making $80,000, they're gonna get a credit, okay? If they take $15,000 out of an IRA that we did not anticipate, what happened to their income? It went over. They have to pay it all back. So if they were getting $200 a month for their family's insurance, they just lost $2,400 in their refund. Now, if they're making, what did I say, $80,000, okay, and they only take $10,000 out, they're still below the $95,000, right? So they would only have to pay back a maximum of $2,500. So this form works. What's that? They can try. Yeah. Well, it depends on how everything falls out on the return, but yeah, you can try to do something, but most of the time, you know, it's, you know, they took that money out because they needed it. They obviously don't have liquid money that, you know, they had damage to their house that they couldn't pay, and, you know, didn't qualify for a loss on the Schedule A. And, you know, it's just when I see people take money out of IRAs, it used to be that we always worried about just the 10% penalty if they were under 59 and a half and how much more taxable income it is. Now, it can affect their health insurance. Okay? So not only it's not a double whammy, it's a triple whammy now. Okay? All right? So that's where we have with that.
Do they warn you about these?
Do you think the brokers have any idea what's going on with the health care law? Obviously, if they call the IRS will say, oh, we don't know. Okay? Because they don't know the answers to half the problems. Okay? All right? So, I mean, it's been fun. I mean, because I've done enough of these, and because I'm doing them for everybody in EG Tax, I love calling the IRS and getting an argument about it and going, nah, you're wrong. And pretty soon when I'm done, they're going, oh yeah, okay. The client's looking at me and I'm going, you know, yep, here's your money. Okay. And it is a flawed system. I have another client I'm working on right now that actually I've been in correspondence with an IRS advocate,
that doesn't understand the math either, and Brian Higgins' office, because he's in his congressional district. Because he went in the entire year of 2015, and according to the IRS, he did not have insurance. According to the marketplace, he was enrolled. According to Independent Health, where he paid his premium, he was getting a premium tax credit. Okay, so I just sent off 40 pages. I sent off his application in the marketplace. I sent off all the canceled checks for every month's premium, front and back, to show they were cashed. I sent off the bill from Independent Health each month that showed his premium tax credit on it. I even sent them the fact that Independent Health covered all these procedures. His wife went through cancer treatment throughout the year. Everything was working the way it's supposed to. But the IRS says, because I do not have a 1095A, the marketplace didn't issue one. Independent Health had no record of one. Everything else was in order. The IRS will not give him his refund. Says that he owes money. So by the IRS standards, he should be paying back all the treatment for his wife. But Independent Health wrote a letter to the IRS, and we faxed it to him. Yes, he had health insurance, and this was his premium tax credit. Their response, where's the 1095A? They can't do anything. They just keep getting hung up on this 1095A because there was no information. And I calculated and put it on the bottom of the return as if he had one. They didn't believe me. And then I had to show them how I got the calculations and how I did all the math.
Well, who issues the 1095A?
The New York State of Health, the marketplace. And they can't figure out why. He has an application that he was approved for, but there's no 1095A. Nobody can figure it out.
Well, wouldn't it have been their responsibility?
Yeah.
Then how can they ask?
Well, that was my next question, Michelle. I'm thinking a lot like you. I decided to call the marketplace and say, can you please transfer me to the department that issues 1095A so I can speak to them? Well, there's no phone number for me. We can't transfer you to them. I said, okay, what's the direct phone number? We don't have that. Okay, can I get a fax number and I'll just send them correspondence? We don't have that. How about an email? No.
Say, so can you walk down the hall?
Yeah.
No, I picture this poor little man that's been hired by the government living in the basement of the Capitol building. No electricity, no heat, because he can't have a phone or a computer. And he's just handwriting out these 1095As because apparently I cannot talk to anybody in that department. So yes, obviously it's a flawed system, but 982 pages, it's great. Let's just pass it and we can read about it later and try to work with it. 3 years later, and you wonder why they want to repeal it. Okay. All right. Okay. So let's take about 5 minutes. So we're going to continue on with other taxes, okay? Obviously, these are taxes that you do not see a lot of. We're going to kind of go through them briefly. Down at the bottom of 16.3, we have the alternative minimum tax. Not going to ask that you know the calculations, all right? That'll happen based on somebody with higher income. Kitty tax. That kitty tax is if somebody has unearned income that is on a return and it's in excess of $2,000, they have to do a return and either it is taxed, and most often it is taxed at the parent's rate. So if the parents are in a 25% tax bracket and their child has unearned income, investment income, say that they sold a whole bunch of bonds and had interest income in excess of $2,000, they're paying the kiddie tax. That's what it is, okay? Unreported Social Security and Medicare tax, we've talked about that. Don't worry about the household employment. Anybody got a maid that they're paying here? Okay, maid or butler? Besides those of you that are domestic engineers that should be paying $250,000 a year, that's where you would claim this tax, by the way, if somebody's compensating you for your household duties. Okay.
First-time home buyer credit repayment. Dumbest thing that ever happened. Okay? I don't know what this is all about. Somebody thought it was a good idea, and then it was a bad idea. Because it was only a good idea for about 8 months. Because then they changed it, and there's a window of people, and a very small window, that have to repay this. If they would have bought their house 2 months later, or a little bit earlier, they wouldn't have to worry about repaying this. You're just this little window of people. And on the form, you know the initial amount, and each year, part of the refund goes to pay it back. So they got a big credit in the year that they bought their house as a first-time home buyer. Make sure you ask on this one, because a lot of people, especially new clients, forget about this. And last year for 2015, when we were e-filing returns, it was a rejection on a lot of them. So we'd get these rejection messages that, based on the Social Security number, this person owed the first-time home buyer's credit. We had to get it before we could electronically file the return. Okay. Additional Medicare tax. We've talked about that one. And then we're going to talk about estimated taxes is the big one that I want to cover out of this. Okay. All right. So, like I said, you can read about alternative minimum tax there. Because as you see on 16.6, it looks like its own tax return. Okay? All right. Nothing like in having a form that's 35 lines long just to figure out a tax. Because if you double those lines, you got a 1040 and think all the things we got to do on there. Okay? But again, just kind of read through and understand. And then if you haven't figured it out by then, you can go to page 2 of that form and get the rest of the lines, all right, up to line 64, okay? So, can't get to sleep tonight, Fred. Read the instructions for the alternative minimum tax, okay? All right, kitty tax. Again, I just want to talk about this one because we do see this every once in a while. For children under age 18 and certain older children described below, income over 2100 is treated as the parent's rate if the parent's rate is higher than the child's. Okay, so obviously, unearned income like this, investment income or whatever you want to call it, is going to be taxed, and the IRS wants to get the biggest chunk of tax they can. So as it talks about there, there's a form 8615 that you use. You're going to put in there about the unearned income. And, you know, the child's had more than 2100 of unearned income. Okay. They're going to file a tax return. And like I said, on that tax return, you're going to put information in about the parent's return, like their taxable income and such. And then it's going to calculate their tax rate. And most of the time, it creates a huge tax bill because they're paying it at the parent's tax rate. Okay. So that's what the kitty tax is. All right. Now, instead of the child filing it, you can see on page 1610, it gives you the instructions that the parents can elect to report the child's interest in dividends on their return. Okay? So there are things where you can do that where it can go directly to the parents' return with the election. Yes. It depends on what vehicle it is. Because if it's such that you are, you know, the investment or a trust or whatever it is coming that's creating the unearned income is in both your names. Okay? Because, you know, you think about some things that, you know, kids get money from a trust or whatever that's unearned that may be in the parent's name because until they're a certain age, it's not actually theirs. So you got to kind of trace whose Social Security number it's under. Okay? I've seen that with bonds where somebody got a bunch of bonds when they were born. It ended up under the parent's Social Security number, but they were in the kids' names because the child did not have a Social Security number yet. And, well, IRS is going to cash those in, and that's what's the Social Security number that they're going to see. So, you know, it just, you got to kind of trace the steps as to where it comes from and whose Social Security number it's under. Okay? All right. And, like I said, those other ones we're going to have you read about, you know, all those things we kind of did on some of our W-2 information about the additional tax on Social Security and Medicare because of, you know, what was done on our W-2s. If we have our W-2s and they're from two sources, okay, because if we have a W-2 that we paid excess Social Security and Medicare, who do we go to? The employer. Two or more, who do we go to? Yeah, the tax return. Okay. All right. Okay. Okay. 1626. All right. It talks about tax withholding and estimated taxes. Basically, what we're looking at here is, remember that section we kept bypassing? I said we'd come back to eventually, where we put in that tax paid for the state on line 65 of the 1040, page 2. Obviously, the first one we have is federal income tax withheld. That one calculates, because where's that coming from? Chances are W-2 or Social Security statement, our retirement compensations, all those that have withholding comes right over there. All right. If we have some withholdings on 1099s that aren't carried over, you can see on that part two, there's a green number. Okay. So right underneath here, some things that may not have gone on a 1099B or withholding that we have that are withholding that we know about, but weren't on any forms. We can put that on there. Okay. Don't see that very often. The big one we're going to talk about is line 65. So if you want to click in there, hit your link, and we're going to go to that federal state payments. Okay? All right. So that F/S, okay, should look like this one. Remember, it's the one, like I said, down there where we pay that New York state. We pay tax at New York State for last year. We put it on there and it carries to our Schedule A. All right, so up at the top, okay, we have the fact that we've made estimated payments. Sometimes people do this because of self-employment, or they have a pension that won't take withholding out. That does happen. IRAs and pensions and annuities refuse to do withholding, especially on the state side. But we know that we're going to have a tax liability. Okay? I have a gentleman that comes to me. I don't know where he got them, but he has all these World War II bonds. He's coming in to cash them, and it's about $80,000 of interest income. Yeah. So he must have supported one side of the war. But we always have to calculate his interest income. Well, no withholding. He cashes these bonds, comes to me and says, here's what I got, here's the interest. What do I do? Well, each of these four payments, you're going to pay X number of dollars. Because otherwise, when he comes to see me to do his tax return, okay, very nice Italian man. He always brings me wine. I don't drink wine, but my wife seems to like it. So, it's the first time I told him this, and he came to me, and I said, well, we paid a little too much, so you got a refund this year. He goes, I haven't had a refund in years. And I said, well, it's not like I did any magic. It's just that you were used to paying $10,000, $20,000, $30,000 plus penalty on your tax return because you're cashing these bonds. All right? So we have all these, and you make these payments, and you see the months that they pay them. You can, and some people will do this if they have excess. And that's what I suggested with him. I said, well, if you're not used to a refund, let's just take the refund and credit it to next year. So if I have a $3,000 refund, I can say, no, I don't want it. Just keep it on the tabs. And then that would carry over from last year. And you'd see that amount. Okay? Now, if
Somebody has several years where they've had excessive balances due, the IRS will send you a letter and says you are required to do estimating because you're not paying your taxes timely throughout the year. The IRS and New York State love this one. Okay? Bunch of letters coming out from New York State right now. If somebody owed more than $1,000 for 2013, they are sending out letters to them as penalties because they did not pay timely in 2013. Not like it's last year, it's 2013. You guys all remember what you were doing taxes in 2013? I'm having trouble remembering what I did when I got up this morning, okay? But we're getting these letters. One of the things I get out, a lot of people are getting them. Two of mine just called and said, they didn't live in New York in 2012. Okay, they don't have to pay it. So I just had to send a copy of their 2012 return sign that showed where they lived. So those are the clients that are smart enough to bring us the letters. What are other people going to do? Oh my gosh, I owe money to the government. Write their check and mail it off.
Is there any other way to get out of it?
There's several. Yeah, there's several. So, but obviously they panic when they get that nice little certified letter. Okay? But this is where we have to do this. Now, the other thing, too, is if you have a W-2 employee, they may be mandated to do estimated, or if they're not doing proper withholding and have a balance due, the IRS will call their employer and change their withholding for them. And the employer will be required to make them file single zero maximum withholding for several years. Because they were going exempt trying to get their big check and not pay taxes and then didn't pay the tax bill. And this has kind of gone on for 2 or 3 years. And they say, I can't pay my tax bill. Well, let us help you do that. Okay? We'll just take part of your paycheck every week as withholding like you're supposed to. Okay? But basically what this is saying is you have to do this when you have a balance due. And it's a recurring thing. Like I said, a lot of times this is self-employed people. Because they're not having federal tax withheld, plus on their return they have Social Security and Medicare done through the self-employment tax. So it's always a good idea if they're going to have profits to do this. Okay. Down below is the same thing. Okay, but for the state. All right. So it shows the states that you're in. You got balance due. This is where we talked about. Remember that 520 I told you about that one time? This is where we put that state balance due from the previous year that was paid in 2015. But we can do same thing. We can keep our refund and have it credited. It'll carry here for somebody that's a previous client, or it'll show up on the return. And then we can do this. Now, this is always a good one too, okay? You have until January 15th to pay the fourth installment. Okay, on the state side, you ask them, did you pay it before December 31st? Why would that be advantageous? Where does state taxes paid go? Where's it go on our return?
Schedule A.
Yeah. So if they pay it before in the year that we're doing taxes for, it'll add to their itemized deductions. Doesn't do any help on the federal. But if we make all four payments in one calendar year, it'll help us on our itemized. Okay? If they don't, that'll be credited next year. Okay? So that's always a good thing to tell them to do. All right? Okay? And like I said, calculating the estimated taxes. When you do estimated taxes, the one thing that's nice about the software is... if you go to the add a form, okay, and that's the one that looks like this page, and you scroll down a little, whoops, I guess I got to scroll up because I'm in the wrong spot. You scroll up a little bit, see where it says 1040 ES? Okay, if you open that page, you can put that on their return, and again, you're kind of projecting things and pull things from their return, but it's a nice little worksheet. How much money do you think you're going to make on your self-employment next year? Or what's your pension going to be that you're drawing next year that they won't do withholding? and you just kind of ask them a question, and you can kind of fill it in based on the information that you know about their return. And then down at the bottom, it calculates the estimated amount, and then it'll be nice enough to make them little vouchers that they'll print out with their return. Oddly enough, it has directly where to pay and how to pay it to the IRS. All right. Or if I know that somebody's going to have, well, I want to put $1,000 ahead of time. Well, on that line that says estimated desired, I can skip all the worksheet, put in $1,000, and you can see it just broke it up for me. And then I can print them out vouchers and say, hey, you need to pay these. Okay? So you see that second to last line that's yellow? It says estimated desired if different from required. And a lot of times, you know, I'll do the calculation or, you know, estimation. Okay? And how can we get that number another way? Does anybody remember? What's the magical little thing that you can do the return that you're...
What if?
So you can make up and do the what if mode, change some things in the return, and then up in the box in the corner, for this case, you owe $3,200. My suggestion is you make some estimated payments to avoid penalties from the IRS. Because like they said, if you're not paying your taxes timely, is the word they use. Timely means that you need to pay them throughout the year. You can't always wait till the end, especially if you're not paying it at the end of the year. They don't like that either. After 2 or 3 years, like I said, they're going to go change your W-2. They're going to start taking your refunds. And I think I told you about the client I did that he's a real estate broker on commercial properties and doing his return. I should say I started his return. I refused to do it because he started manipulating the numbers to show a bigger profit so he could get a mortgage. As I talked to him more, found out that he never pays his taxes. So each year he has $10,000, $12,000 tax bill to the federal government, but he's been doing this to show that his income's higher so that he can get a mortgage and buy a house. And he was approved. So, I don't know what's going to happen to the house, and the IRS decides it wants its money, but, and as he started doing that, I'm like, I'm sorry, I cannot do your return any longer, okay? Because that's fraud. He was manipulating the numbers. He had nothing for him, okay? So, you get in a situation like that, you ask your office supervisor or bring somebody else in so that they understand the situation. We're never going to put you on the spot for it, but if it doesn't feel right, as the old adage go about, if it walks like a duck and it quacks like a duck, it's probably a duck. Okay? All right? This time of year, it might be one of those, what do they call those things? Turbuckins? Mm-hmm. Those things that they stuff all the meat inside each other. All right? Okay? So, that's where we have all that. Okay? So, that's where the estimated taxes are. And it can talk about there on the tax withholding and things, you know, if somebody's not doing it, you know, there is penalties on there. When you talk to somebody about their withholding, all right, make sure that they understand that basically on their income, they're going to pay tax one way or the other. They want big paychecks or do they want a big refund? They like big paychecks, they can lower their withholding, but I mean, it's a small refund. Okay. All right. Everybody kind of gathers that because you're going to pay the tax one way or the other at some point. All right, if you want to write down yourmoneypage.com, okay, yourmoneypage.com. I use this all the time. I know it's kind of cheesy looking, but. I keep this as a shortcut. When somebody wants to talk to me about their withholding. All right, so we got a new job. It's going to be in the state of New York. Okay.
So now I can say, all right, this is for the upcoming year. They are single. And they're going to claim zero in both of them. Okay, so it's claiming, you can see how it says my withholding allowances. This is what they do on their W-4 and such. All right, they didn't live in New York City. They get paid weekly. And they make $1,000, okay? And we're not going to worry about any special cafeteria deductions or anything. So once I hit calculate, I can say to them, each week, this is what you're going to take home. And then this is great because if I have somebody that's come to me and for the first 3 months they're not doing withholding and they had a balance due last year, I can say, hey, if I take this number times 52, it better darn well cover your tax bill. Otherwise, you're going to owe at the end of the year. But they can say, you know what? With my bills each month, I can't live on that. Okay? All right. Well, let's go back. All right. And we're going to change the inputs. We're going to bump you up and let you do single two. So you'll claim two allowances. Okay? And then when I calculate, I can say, now you're going to get an extra $50 a week. Okay, I can do that. But I want you to remember, instead of paying what was that, $157 each week, you're only paying in $118. Better hope that that covers your tax bill at the end of the year. Because otherwise, right now, I just took away from your refund. I put in your paycheck and took away from your refunds. So you can show them right there. Because when they see the numbers, they're thinking, well, look at that. Yeah, that's great. I like that paycheck. Okay. But guess what? You just got part of your refund each week. Okay? So, yeah, so it's a great way to show it. It's pretty simple to use. It's just called your money page.
This is better than that IRS one. You can exercise. It says, go to IRS.
Of course. You got to do the worksheet. Yeah.
But it doesn't get steep for you. It's federal.
Yeah. Well, of course. What's the IRS want you to do? Give as much money as you can to them. You realize the IRS is under the Department of the Treasury, right, Fred? And what's the Department of the Treasury do? Pays all the bills for the government, okay? So you don't think that they're going to want money coming into the coffers, or do you want to think they want to leave with all of it? That's why tax, you know, income tax is always such a hot political office or topic, because what do they want to do? You know, depending on the way income tax works, you may want to keep the money in the pocket of the consumer so that it grows the economy. Well, you have to cut government spending because it's not coming into the government. All right. And if you guys get a chance, I think they're on the YouTube channel, but the last couple shows that Esther's done on the radio have been great because she's been talking about 16 versus 17 as far as the changes. What I'm saying is that there's a lot of things that you may want to try to do before the end of the year or wait till the next year. Okay. If somebody's thinking about doing a Roth IRA conversion, when I convert from my traditional to my Roth, what do I have to do with that money going in? Pay a tax on it. Well, right now that person's tax might be 25%, but because of what's going to happen in 17, they waited and did that after the first year, it might only be taxed at 15%. So before you do anything right now that's going to have anything to do with converting money that creates tax, you don't want to talk. And according to your financial advisor first, and then whoever's doing your taxes, which is you, okay? Because that is going to be a component. It's going to add to your taxable income. And if you're going to be in a 15% bracket next year instead of 25, well, there's a lot of things that you could wait until the first year to do if you don't need the money right away. Okay? Equally, the other thing with taxes, with withholding, anybody that has earned income credit, none of those refunds will be issued until February 15th.
Same thing for the additional child tax credit. They're delaying anybody that has either one of those, earned income credit or the additional child tax credit, because they're kind of those blank refunds, refundable credits. They're delaying them so that they give time for everybody that's trying to get them to make sure there's no fraud and repetition or where children are used twice. Because there's billions of dollars in fraud there. All right? So that's one thing she's been talking about, where you can talk to somebody, and we've been talking about it. Maybe they need to change their withholding between now and when they get the refund, because they need the money in their pocket because their refund's going to be delayed, and maybe they use that refund to pay property taxes or bills from the holidays or whatever. Hey, don't pay your tax right now. Get your entire paycheck. Change it back after you get your refund, because your refund's going to be delayed. For those people that rely on a refund to pay off bills and property tax or whatever else from the end of the year. Okay? So that's waves through. Because if I have somebody go exempt here, I could have somebody, you know, if I put 10 in here, oops, don't laugh, I see it. Okay? So I put 10 in there. Okay? Nice paycheck now. I just increased their paycheck. Okay? But that's all that's being withheld. So yeah, you know, for these 4 weeks and maybe the first, so I'm going to have about 8 or 9 paychecks with an extra $200 in it. I kept $1,600 in my pocket. Well, I got $1,600 in my pocket that's going to be part of my refund. They have to understand that. But it's a way for you to get part of your refund ahead of time instead of this delay, if you have the earned income credit or the additional child tax credit. Okay? All right? That makes sense to everybody? Congratulations. You're now a financial advisor. You're now a doctor. You know healthcare. Let's see, what else can we say that you did? So, okay? All right? Okay. All right. Any questions about the additional taxes or estimated taxes, withholding, things like that? Like I said, there's a lot of stuff that's in there that you just need to know for reference. The big one I wanted you to understand is if somebody comes in with the kiddie tax, you know, that additional over 2,100, because you do see it. And like I said, most often I see it with bonds, because there were somewhere along the line somebody got bonds purchased in their name as a gift when they're born or graduated or whatever, and they cash them, you know. That's on earned income, okay? And then the other one, the big thing is the estimated taxes, understanding that you need to pay it timely to withhold it, okay?
Jim, on the kiddie tax, is that always optional from the parents that just elect to put that child's unearned income on their return?